right. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. All right, don't mind these people. These are just my friends. I love them. They're great friends. Don't mind them. They're the peanut gallery. But guys, Jeff already introduced me a little bit, but my name is Larry Geisler. I'm one of the student pastors over at our Rolling Meadows campus. And I just think this is so awesome that we are one church, right? We're in many locations and we're all reaching people for Jesus. It is really, really awesome. So I am super glad to be here. Jeff, thank you for inviting me to be over here, spend time with the cathedral family this morning. I'm really excited. But just a couple things about me so you can kind of get the gist of where I'm coming from, some things that make me who I am. One, a place I really, really love is Liberty University. Graduated from there in 2019. I loved every single second of it. I know we got a lot of moody people in the house. Wow, all right, there's a lot of moody people in the house. That's great, that is great. I got to know Dr. V a little bit, love him. So we're you know, solving the rivalry between Moody and Liberty right now. But I love Liberty, and my youngest sister actually goes there right now. She's a sophomore, and my family has come to love that place so much that we literally refer to it as the second happiest place on earth. Which is pretty good. That's like pretty high praise, the second happiest place on earth. Now, if you're anything like me, you probably know where I'm going with this. You'd probably know what the happiest place on earth is, which my family also loves, which is Walt Disney World. Any Disney fans? Okay, crazy people like me. Okay, some of us just became best friends. Some of you are wondering a little bit about me because I am what many people would call a Disney adult. I love Disney that much. I watch the Disney shows. I go to the Disney parks. I watch the Disney. I love it. I am a Disney adult. I'm not that weird, though. I don't have Disney tattoos. I don't know if you have Disney tattoos, but that I'm clean. But this is something that my family loves to do, is go to the Disney parks. We go to all four. There was one year we even had season passes because we went so much. We lived in Pennsylvania. So I was basically raised on pineapple, Dole Whip, and churros. That is what makes me who I am. I love it so much. And we just went last January. And this time that we were there, my sister started doing this thing where she would vlog our days in Disney World. You know, like those influencers, they make millions of dollars to just take video of their life and post it on YouTube. This is what she was trying to accomplish. We had a fun time doing it. Didn't make millions of dollars, but it's fun to look back on the memories, right? Of eating pineapple Dole Whip and churros and riding the rides and plowing over people when the rope drops in the park. It's fun to look back on the memories, but recently I was just going back and looking at one of the videos that my sister took of a day in the life of the Geisler family in Disney World. And I just kind of realized something. I was like, oh my gosh, we are like some consuming people. Like we're consuming food all day long, one snack after another, a big sit down meal. Like, holy cow, we're just, our goal on this vacation is to consume as much food, as much entertainment, and as much fun as we possibly can. That's the entire goal. And granted, I'm on vacation. I'm gonna enjoy the good gifts that God has given me. I'm gonna live it up in the magic of Disney World. But the dangerous thing there is that, yes, that could be my life on vacation maybe a little bit, but that can kind of become a day in my actual life pretty quickly. That consuming mindset, that it's all about me, really. And that's really, really a problem. It's really a problem because when God saved me from myself, that's what it is to know Jesus, to be saved from ourselves. He didn't save me to be a consumer. The Lord saved me so that I could contribute. He brought me into his kingdom so that I could contribute to his kingdom. So my question is, what does a day in our lives actually look like? Because I think if I took a transparent look at my life and I did a day in the life of Larry Geisler, I would see a lot more of a consumer mentality than I should have, a lot more comfort than there should be. And I know that God is calling us to something different. He's calling us to something better. And what we're gonna see in our passage today is exactly that. It is a calling to contribute to the kingdom of God. So we're gonna be in Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. You're gonna need a Bible, so get that out. And as you're grabbing your Bible, I just wanna remind us of some things that we've been talking about the last month or so in this series. Of all these things that happen in Acts chapter 2 that inform what we're gonna learn today. We need to know these things to understand what the apostles are doing. So right, we saw the Holy Spirit come on all those who believe, and he indwelt them. And so immediately now, with the power of the Holy Spirit, there is a power available to the believers that they didn't have before. It's new, it's fresh. So they have a power they didn't have. And then we heard the last 2 weeks what the church is committed to, these 10 marks of a healthy church. So we know that the people of the church, they're committed to some things. They're committed to unity. They are committed to prayer. They're committed to gathering. They're committed to thankfulness and so many other things. But there's one mark of the church that keeps the focus not on themselves, that they wouldn't be consumers, but that the focus would then get pushed to somebody else, to contributing to the kingdom. And that's that healthy churches are committed to reaching lost people. They're committed to reaching lost people. And immediately after Luke tells us what the church does, and at the end of Acts chapter 2, he tells us what the church does, and then he shows us how they do it right here. This is a day in the life of the church. It's what a day in our lives should look like, because what we see in this story is not just done once, it is a pattern, it's a model for us that's repeated over and over and over again throughout the book of Acts. It's the model of what the church should be. So we're gonna start reading Acts chapter 3, verse 1. It says, "Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. And a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple." Alms just meaning money. He's asking for money. So we're gonna pause here real quick. Because before we talk about some of the amazing, really miraculous things that are gonna happen here, we need to know, why are Peter and John going to the temple? Why are they going up there at all? Because yeah, it says they're going up at the hour of prayer. We know at what time they're going, but it doesn't say that they're going up for the hour of prayer. Because the reality is, now that the Holy Spirit has come, things are different for them. They have access to the Father through Jesus, that they don't need to go to the temple to pray. It's not necessary. They're not bound to Jewish ritual anymore, even though they're Jews. There's nothing getting them to the temple that they can receive, something that they want to have that they can't have anywhere else. I mean, there's nothing for them. This is like me walking into a Bass Pro Shop. I am not an outdoorsman. I've never shot a gun. I've never been hunting. I don't own a boat. I don't go fishing. I don't do any of that stuff. There's no reason for me to step foot into a Bass Pro Shop. There's nothing for me there. There's nothing for me at the Bass Pro. There's nothing for Peter and John at the temple. Nothing that they can receive that they don't already have. Which then would beg the question, why are they going? The reason for them going up there must be something else than what they want to receive. And here's something that John Calvin said about this very scenario where Peter and John are going up to the temple. He says, if any man ask whether the apostles went up into the temple that they might pray according to the rite of the law, I don't think that this is a thing so likely to be true, as they might have better opportunity to spread abroad the gospel. So reaching the lost, that's what we see Peter and John doing here. They have witnessed the power of God in their lives. They have witnessed the Holy Spirit come and empower them to build God's church. And now they go to the lost people. So the first thing we see in this passage is that witnesses go to lost people. That's what they do. And Peter and John are making an intentional choice to go where the people are with the sole intent of sharing the gospel with them and nothing else. They want these people to know Jesus. This is not a one-time evangelistic event where we get the whole church together and we go out on a Saturday and we say, guys, this Saturday we're all gonna go to the temple and we're gonna evangelize people. It's gonna be great, and then we'll go do the same thing next year. No, they did this all the time. It's the pattern of the church. They would go to the temple, they would preach the gospel, people would come to know Jesus, they would get arrested, they would break out of prison, and they would go right back to the temple. It was the pattern of the church. They're persistent in their intent to see people come to know Jesus. So if Peter and John are any example for us to follow, which they definitely are, these are the models that we should follow, then we would see that reaching the lost doesn't just happen. It requires an intentional decision. We don't often just bump into people who then start asking us questions about who Jesus is. If anything, I think, you know, we just miss opportunities to share Jesus with people that are right in front of us because it's not our norm. It's not a pattern that has been established in our lives. So if we want to get serious about reaching the lost people in our community, reaching the lost people in our lives, we have to make a choice to go where they are. It doesn't just happen. So you might be thinking, well, yeah, there are lost people everywhere, so it wouldn't be that hard for me to find a place to go, which is mostly true. You walk out these doors, you're gonna see tons of people who don't know the love of Christ, who don't call him Lord of their life. But that doesn't mean that when we're around them, our sole intent is to share the gospel with them. More often, we're kind of just going about our business, because again, it's not in the normal pattern of our lives. But there is something very different about going to a specific place with the sole intent of I am going to reach lost people for Jesus. That's why I'm going to this place. That's why I'm going to this event. That's why I'm investing in this person, because I have the intent for them to know Jesus. And a cool thing about this passage is that in no place does it say that Peter and John were witnessing to a stranger. It doesn't say that they didn't know this guy, this lame man who was sitting at the gate. Think about it, he's been lame since birth, the day he was born. And it says the people lay him at the temple gate daily. Every day he gets laid down here. And this is not Peter and John's first time in the temple. They've been there quite a bit for the last couple of years with Jesus. So I think there's a pretty good shot. This isn't in the Bible, but I think they know this guy. They've seen him before. They might even know his name. And so they're going to a place that they are already familiar with and witnessing to somebody they already know. And I think we can do that same exact thing. I think that's the model for us, to go to a place that we are familiar with, to find somebody we know and care for them, get to know them better. And sure, we can go to a random park that we've never been to before and see a bunch of people we've never met before and ask questions and share the gospel with them. And that's glorifying to God. That's planting seeds in their life. But would it be better if we went to a place we've already been to? If we witnessed to somebody that we already know? Because I think what we're gonna see in this story is sharing the gospel, yes, it is intentional, but it's not just intentional. It's very personal. It requires knowing somebody, caring for somebody. So where can you go and make a personal connection with somebody who needs Jesus? Where's that place for you? See, as I was preparing this, I realized very quickly that I'm not very good at this. Hardly ever am I saying, I'm gonna go out today with the sole intent of sharing the gospel with somebody. I think I fall into the pastor syndrome of, oh, people wanna, you know about Jesus, they're gonna come to me. And I think we all kind of fall into that, but it's not true. So I was like, all right, God, what is gonna change here? What are we gonna do? And a place came to my mind. There's a coffee shop that I go to quite often in Arlington Heights. And I just hang out, I do work, I have meetings. But I'm there pretty frequently and I see a lot of faces of the people who work there all the time. I don't know their names. So I committed, said, God, I am going to go to this coffee shop every single Monday and it's not gonna be for work. It's not the reason I'm going. It's not gonna be to hang out with friends, but I'm going to go to a place that I already know with people that I've seen to get to know them, learn something about their life, and share the testimony of how Jesus has changed my life with them. And see what God would do. And sure, like I'll probably be pretty uncomfortable at times. I'll probably say some really dumb things that make no sense whatsoever. But I'm going to do that because I have witnessed God do a miracle in my life. As so many of us here have witnessed God do miracles. And witnesses go to lost people. That's what we do. So I think we can all choose a place. We can choose one place that we're going to go to intentionally to share the gospel with people who need it. And we're gonna go witness to lost people. But now, what happens next in this story is a miracle, no doubt. And we're gonna camp out here for a little bit because there's a lot for us to really dive into. So let's see, pick up in verse 3. And see what happens with the lame man. It says, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms or money. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, look at us. And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. So let's just pause there, because before we go any further, I want us to kind of remember something that Pastor Tommy talked about a couple weeks ago, of the difference between descriptive and prescriptive texts in the Bible. Right, you've got descriptive things like the creation story and the crucifixion of Christ, where somebody's telling us how things unfolded, an event that happened. And then prescriptive texts that are telling us this is how to follow Jesus, you need to do these things. And what Luke is laying out for us here is a story. It's a descriptive text and he's telling us what happened. And then we take the principles from what happened and we apply them to our lives. So what does it mean about the miraculous nature of healings and things of that sort in this passage? We have to remember, we're not Peter and John. Peter and John are apostles. They are eyewitnesses of Jesus. It says even in Acts 2 there that the apostles were performing signs and wonders. They have a unique gift of apostleship to perform these signs and these wonders because God has given them that gift. None of us in the room are apostles. Not one. We haven't seen Jesus. We can't basically perform signs and wonders on command almost like they did. So what does that mean about miraculous healing? Does God still heal? Well, I think we see throughout Scripture, and a lot of us probably have personal testimonies of how God definitely does still heal. And he does perform miraculous signs, miraculous wonders, just not quite in the same way. It comes through prayer and asking him in the name of Jesus. I actually remember just a couple years ago, I was at a church in Georgia, and I had just joined there, and our high school group was taking a trip to Guatemala. I didn't get to go on the trip, but I got to hear all the stories afterwards of what God did. And here's one of the stories. One of the girls who went on the trip, she was a senior in high school, last opportunity to take one of these missions trips. First day, running around with some kids in Guatemala, she breaks her arm. Clean break in her arm. She was so upset. She's like, I'm not gonna be able to do anything for the rest of this trip. It's over for me. I'm useless. And so the next night, one of the pastors from this church in Guatemala realizes she's just kind of down in the dumps. Seems like she doesn't want to be there. And he notices she has a broken arm, comes up and prays over her. And as he says, amen, just like this lame man, in an instant, her arm was healed. An undeniable, miraculous thing that only God can do. And it was done in the name of Jesus. Prayed for to the Father through the power and the authority that's in the name of Jesus. The apostles healed in the name of Jesus. So when we pray for healing, we pray in the name of Jesus. It's his power, it's his authority that heals. So God heals, but we aren't apostles. So should we pray for healing? I think the answer is yes, we should pray for healing. But should we have doubts about God's character, about his nature, when he doesn't? And that's where we say no. We don't doubt his character. Because he's still near, he's still working. And in fact, this same guy, this lame man at the temple, the funny thing is, Jesus probably walked past him countless times. Time and time again, walking into the temple, walking past this same lame man who's getting healed now, when Jesus could have healed him before. Because it was this moment, not one before, it was this moment that God, in his sovereignty, ordained for this man to be healed and to come to know who he was. So we pray for healing, we trust God's sovereignty above everything else, and we don't try to force his hand. He's God, we're not. So that's my little side note on healing, but what do we see here in the subtle things that Peter and John are doing? Because there's some subtle things that we can really draw out here. I want us to picture what's happening to this lame man as he's sitting at this massive temple gate. Just sitting there, I imagine he's been here most days of his life asking for money, so I imagine he's sitting there with his head down, he's, you know, got a cup, and he's just mumbling, kind of saying stuff, asking for money. He's not looking at anybody. And what Peter and John do is something he's probably not very familiar with. They come up to him and hear him asking for money, and they basically say, "Look at me." That disrupts his entire pattern. He's never had anybody probably say, "Look up at me," before. He's just used to asking for money, which is perfectly logical. He can't walk, he can't work, he can't provide for himself. He needs money somehow, so he's asking for money. But it says that Peter and John directed their gaze at him. In words that we're more familiar with, I think that means that Peter and John really took a second to slow down. They slowed down to see through what was superficial, what was on the surface with this guy sitting at the gate of the temple. That this isn't a guy who just needs money. That there's a much more serious need, and they saw through a guy sitting and asking for money to somebody who was broken and in need of a savior. And then they just say, look up, look at me. To disrupt him, to draw him out of his normal patterns of life. Now, when we go sharing the gospel with people, I don't think it would be a good idea to necessarily stare at somebody for a while and then say, "Look at me," because that's like some next level weird. We shouldn't do that. Weird on a lot of levels. But what I do think is that we need to follow the model of disrupting the normal patterns of somebody's life, of just being treated like they're another person lost in the sea of faces. Because I think that this guy was literally shocked when they told him to look up. Because usually people are just dropping money in his cup. Like this, they're Jewish people, this is part of their customs, it's what they're used to doing, just dropping money in his cup. They don't really care about him. But Peter and John, what they did was something different. And I think that people in our lives would be a little bit shocked if we started to ask questions about their spiritual beliefs. That's gonna cause somebody to like wake up from the slumber of like walking through life, be like, "Holy cow, I don't know if anyone's ever asked me that before." And these are the kinds of things that make it personal. Because sharing the gospel, it's not just intentional, it's a personal thing. See, witnessing, it's not about having the right words to say. It's not about winning an argument. It's about taking the time to make a personal connection with someone and showing them that you really care. That you really care for them because Jesus has cared greatly for you. Which so often is exactly what we don't do because our lives are too busy. We have too many things to do, things to accomplish, places to be, and we don't think to slow down, to ask questions, to care for somebody, to see through the superficial, to see through what's on the surface. But it's really cool what happens when this guy actually looks up at them, when he looks up at Peter and John. It says when he looks up, he expected to receive something. Like, the lame man, he probably thought these guys were gonna dump a bucket load of cash on him. Because usually it's just people dropping in coins. They're like, "Look at me." He's like, "Oh, here it comes, the mother load." Because above all else, he thought that his most important need in his life was money. It's what he thought he needed more than anything else. That it would solve all of his problems, but ultimately that's just a temporary solution, the money. He did not have eyes to see that there was more, that he needed more. But thankfully, Peter and John did. So they say, I don't have silver or gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. They saw his need, and they gave him what they had, which was Jesus. So we see in Peter and John that witnesses give what they have. That's the second thing. Witnesses give what they have. Because Peter and John, they didn't have what this guy was looking for. He was looking for money, which the church then was not rich by any stretch. They did not have much money. But they knew that they had something better to offer him. And there's a couple of things that Peter and John have here that we have, that we can give. And the first is salvation in Jesus Christ. If you have given your life to Jesus, if you've been saved by grace and you have dedicated your life to the Lord, then you have what everyone needs. No matter what somebody comes asking you for, you have what they need. No matter what is going on superficially in somebody's life, you have what they need. Salvation in Jesus, a testimony of how Jesus has changed your life. Unspeakable joy and peace that goes beyond all understanding is yours in Christ Jesus. You have a confidence of your eternity spent with your Father in heaven. And everyone needs that. There's no exception. Every person that you encounter, you have something to give them. They need to hear about Jesus and the personal testimony of how he has changed your life. That's what they need. The second thing Peter and John give to this man is the gift of healing that the Lord has given them. And he heals him immediately from a lifelong condition that he's had. And God has given them this gift to perform signs and wonders. And so they use it, they use their gift to make him known, to make Jesus known. So sure, maybe you don't have a gift of healing, but you have gifts. I don't know what they are. Maybe God's given you a gift of encouragement, of mercy, of generosity, of leadership. God has given you a gift, and you can give that gift to somebody. You can use it for his glory because God has designed you specifically to bless others with your gifts. The gifts aren't for you. The gifts are meant to be a blessing to somebody else and to glorify God above all else. We're all witnesses, and witnesses give what they have. So what do you have to give? God will use those gifts to bring people to himself. We just have to be faithful and obedient to use them. And we see it right here with the lame man. So here's how his story ends. We're gonna pick up in verse 8 and see what happens. What happens next? It says, and leaping up, he stood and began to walk, and he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him, as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. So this man, who has been lame since birth, nobody has seen him walk on his feet a day in his life, is now leaping around, running through the temple, and praising God. He is now a witness. He is a witness of the power and the authority and the saving grace of Jesus. This guy is a witness, and he's letting everybody know. And witnesses glorify God always. They glorify him always. If you're a witness of what God can do, and he has miraculously transformed your life, there is no time of your life that is not dedicated to glorifying God. See, this guy, because of his physical ailment of not being able to walk, he had never been in the temple. He sat at the gate his entire life, watching people walk in, encounter God, walk out. He never got to go in. He probably thought that he never would. But God, in his grace, made a way. He made a way for this man. He did what he thought was impossible. He healed him physically so he could enter the temple, but I think this is it's a symbol of what God did in him spiritually. Because not only did he walk into the temple for the first time, but he experienced the sweetness of knowing his heavenly Father that he was created for the first time. Now he was able to enter into the presence of his Father in heaven through salvation in Jesus. It was a miracle for him, and that's a miracle for us, that we can have that. And he glorifies God in his excitement, in his newfound salvation. And he's a witness, so he lets everybody know. But witnesses don't just glorify God when it's exciting. They glorify God always. So I think we've learned from both the lame man to celebrate the miracle of our salvation in Christ, but we learn from Peter and John as well. We learn that God is just as glorified through our faithfulness to him. In going to lost people, of giving them what we have, the good news, our gifts that God has given us. He's just as glorified in that. He's glorified in that even when it's hard, even when things seem like they're just not going our way, that we are still committed to contributing to the kingdom. That we're committed to reaching lost people. And that is glorifying God always. So how can we do that? Who's the person that God has placed in your life specifically that you can take the time to care for? That you can see through the surface level things, the superficial things, and see what they actually need. That it's Jesus. So find that person, find that place. Care about what those people care about. know something about them and share the good news of what Jesus has done in your life, because you are a witness. You've seen what he can do. We're all witnesses, and we all glorify God through the way that we testify of what he's done in our lives. Let's pray. Lord, we just confess that, God, sometimes we're just not about the things that you're about. That, God, we don't always give ourselves for your kingdom, and we get caught up in consuming and being about us. But Lord, I pray that you would shift something in us today. God, would you make us about adding to your church, adding to your kingdom? And God, we can't do it on our own. We don't have the words to say. We don't know where to go. So God, we just pray that your spirit would lead us in that. Would it be your voice that directs us? Your voice that speaks through us? Your power that uses the gifts that you've given us to bring people to Jesus? So Lord, we commit to reaching lost people around us. We commit to what you want to do in and through our lives. And we lift that all up to you in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.